audiobook titled The Gospel of Peace, You Will Save the World, Apocalypse or Kingdom of Heaven, That is the Dilemma, The Gospel of Peace, written by Davide Appi, narrated by Subhash Chander, publisher Tech Time. Dedication. This book is dedicated to all the sages, prophets, and masters who, throughout human history, have dedicated their lives to leading humanity towards an awakening of global consciousness. Men and women of every race and culture who have made and written history and who have brought us messages and teachings of great wisdom, living examples of a new world that is about to be born. These beings represent the way, the truth, and the life, and they should guide our lives, illuminate our path, and point the way to a better world. The Gospel of Peace. You will save the world. The only sure thing is that we know nothing, we do not know, and therefore we do not judge. We focus on unconditional love to all and everything, and then what will be, will be. Davide Appi. Love and do what thou wilt. Whether thou keep silent out of love. Whether thou speak, speak out of love. Whether thou correct, correct out of love. Whether thou forgive, forgive out of love. Let the root of love be in thee, for from this root nothing but good can proceed. Saint Augustine. They fear love because it creates a world they can't control. George Orwell. Table of Contents. Chapter 1. Introduction. Chapter 2. Preliminary Remarks. Chapter 3. Peace and Unconditional Love. Chapter 4. Violence versus Kindness. Chapter 5. Peace in the World. Chapter 6. The Prophecy of Peace. Chapter 7. Meditation. Chapter 8. Telepathy. Chapter 9. The Maharishi Effect. Chapter 10. Scientific Studies Maharishi Effect. Chapter 11. Quantum Physics. Chapter 12. Relevant Scientific Aspects. Chapter 13. Modern Science, Ancient Knowledge. Chapter 14. Meditation for Peace. Chapter 15. Meditation Techniques for Peace. Chapter 16. Those Who Take Care of Peace. Chapter 17. Epilogue. Chapter 18. Conclusions. Chapter 19. Appendix. Information on the author. Author's Notes and Contacts. Chapter 1. Introduction. How the book came about. This book came about by chance. A few years ago, I took part in a group meditation for peace, and it was love at first sight. Subsequently, I participated in other meditations also for peace, and my interest in the subject grew. I wanted to extrapolate the most important information in order to create a leaflet to be printed and donated to spread the word about this prodigious exercise, which is as simple as it is effective. So I began the first research to write what would become my information leaflet. So I began to write. Soon the amount of information I had accumulated and the madness of writing made me realize that I was writing a book rather than a leaflet. So this book is a somewhat grown-up leaflet, born by chance and intended to be a source of inspiration for all those who love both the subject of peace and meditation. Meditation as a path to wisdom. Some say it is useless to love because there are bad people. I don't know if I will change the world, but I will not allow the world to change me. When we reach a state of deep meditation, we can resent the present moment, and this connects us to unconditional love. People who do not feel love are disconnected from the infinite, but also from other human beings and the rest of creation. When we feel the infinite, we feel one with everything, everywhere and forever. We are a part of the infinite that for a brief moment is conscious, or rather likely to be conscious of existing. This consciousness makes us feel good and develops in us a sense of connection and love for ourselves and for the world around us. This leads us to become messengers of hope and harmony, bearers of joy and smiles in society, and to embody the change we want to see come about in the world. But all this, if it remains only a theory, has no real effect on our lives. We need to directly experience the experience of connection with the infinite. And to do this, meditation is indispensable. What can we do for world peace? Do we have the power to change the world? Sometimes we feel we are victims of fate and believe we are powerless, especially when it comes to world events. We feel so small and without any possibility of being able to change things. We feel like spectators of a script we never wanted to live through, and we feel we can do nothing to change the course of events. But is this really the case? Take, for example, the wars that are still tearing our planet apart today. Are we really powerless in the face of them? In reality, we are extremely powerful, but few people tell us this, and we have in ourselves an exceptional tool for change. We are already the change that we want to see realized in the world. It is already within us. We just must externalize it. More and more people are ready to revise their existential paradigm. The idea of connection is emerging in more and more fields, and it is something very intuitive. The idea of an interconnected world is much more sensible and exciting than a separate and divided world. More and more people feel that there is something that unites us, that connects us to each other, and that connects us to the whole. It is a basic philosophical concept that does not need much rational explanation. Rather, it can be simply felt and experienced intuitively. The idea of interconnectedness gives meaning to the whole and to our existence. And it is from this interconnection that unconditional love is born, which can be experienced within us and is a pillar for change in our world. Humanity facing future choices. We are at a fundamental crossroads in human history. One path leads us, at best, to a tyranny of a few individuals who subjugate the masses, and at worst, we risk leading our own species to extinction. The other path would lead us to the first true civilization in our history, a peaceful and evolved humanity where the rights and prosperity of all are guaranteed. Which way will we follow? Which side of human nature will we let prevail? At present, the path of aggression and the most stupid human nature seems to triumph, leading us into perpetual conflict with ourselves, nature, and our fellow human beings. This devastating drift comes from a destructive vision of the world, from the division generated by competition, from the scarcity of resources that justifies the perennial conflict for control of them, and from the exasperated careerism for the need to excel over others. In this perspective, fear and scarcity are the engine of a society that is heading towards its own self-destruction. But we should not despair, for we can see the current self-defeating behavior of our society as the metaphor of the caterpillar that becomes a butterfly. The caterpillar destroys its ecosystem to appease its greed. It can eat the equivalent of 300 times its own weight in a single day. When it goes to sleep, its skin hardens and it becomes a chrysalis from which the butterfly will be born. For a certain period of time, the old represented by the caterpillar coexists with the new that is about to be born. The function of the caterpillar is to preserve its life while waiting for the birth of the future butterfly. To paraphrase, we can say that we currently live in a world dominated by a greedy minority like the caterpillar, but the metamorphosis to which we can all contribute will transform the planet into an earthly paradise like the butterfly. If we love butterflies, we cannot kill caterpillars. If we kill the caterpillars to punish them for their avarice and misdeeds, we could not witness the birth of butterflies. The caterpillar enables the birth of butterflies, just as the current myopic society will lead us to a new world. We cannot hate the caterpillar, just as we cannot hate the immature people who currently run the world. Will we be able to let our wiser, more loving and creative side triumph, capable of solving all the current problems and difficulties? The great change. I have no doubt that the world needs a great change, better still a true revolution. But we cannot change the world if we do not change ourselves first. The good news is that the world changes when we meditate. We will see this later in the book. Our only weapons are good daily action and meditation. Share this knowledge with others. The more people who meditate for world peace, the greater the changes in us and in society. So happy revolution to all. Chapter 2. Preliminary remarks. Matter, energy, information. Three ways of looking at the same reality. As Albert Einstein demonstrated with his famous formula E=mc², energy and matter are the same thing. But as well known as this formula is, its implications have not yet been grasped by society as a whole. We are used to seeing material things as real, to focusing on concrete things, but matter is in fact a form of energy. We think that an object and light are two different things, but Einstein showed us that they are the same thing. Moving from thinking in terms of matter to thinking in terms of energy is an epoch-making change, the implications of which we have not yet fully grasped. Matter is a form of energy, and energy itself can be regarded as a form of mass. However, Einstein and quantum physics itself have translated into scientific terms what ancient cultures have always thought, namely that everything is matter, everything is energy, and everything is information. Matter, energy, information are three different ways of looking at the same reality. Everything that happens to us should be taken as a message, a series of information to be deciphered. The universe is matter, the universe is energy, the universe is information, and it constantly interacts with us through the same matter, the same energy, and the same information. As we will see later in this book, this paradigm shift is the key to a rediscovery of our inner power, which we can use to modify the reality in which we live. The thought creates. We said in the previous paragraph that everything is matter, energy, and information, and in this context, one of the tools we have to interact with reality is our thought. Thought is a process of creating reality. But what kind of world are we creating today with our current thoughts? Most people seem to have negative thoughts and feelings, and this leads society astray. This is what the majority seems to be doing, but we, even though we are largely in the minority, can change the world with the collective intention of peace. We can choose to use our brains constructively, eliminate negative thoughts, and flood the planet with thought forms of peace, gratitude, and love. A universal flood of love. Join us too. Let us create a collective thought of love, and everything will change effortlessly and in common pleasure. It is time to bring together all people who are aware of the power of their thought and who therefore believe in their immense potential. It is now proven that thought affects matter. Thought creates. We want to create a better world of peace and justice through the power of our intent. This positive energy can bring about very important changes on the entire planet. So let us not underestimate the power of our thought. It makes us what we are. This is true on our personal level, but also on the collective and global level. The sum of the thoughts of all human beings makes our humanity what it is today. So let us get down to business, or rather, let us get right thinking. The mind and the illusion of change. A better planet is a dream that starts to come true when each of us decides to improve ourselves. Mahatma Gandhi. We must unhinge ourselves before we can change society, because in our ordinary state of mind, we are nothing more than ignorant and unaware agents of the system working to maintain the status quo. The ordinary mind thinks it can change things, but it cannot. It creates the illusion of change that proves to be futile, that nothing really changes, and that everything remains as it is. So the ordinary mind is not capable of creating real change, and we need to go beyond it, because we are meant to be free and not slaves to something, be it fears or conditioning that dominates our own mind. We who work for real change are like a command, an epigenetic message that will change the world. We are here to send a message of confidence, hope, and enthusiasm that changes ourselves and the whole planet. But how do we go beyond the mind to generate real change? Well, a little patience, that's what we'll try to figure out as we read on. Changing our paradigms. It is said that in order to change things, one must first change one's paradigms, and this is probably true. But in my opinion, a real change cannot start from a concept of simple external change. The revolution cannot start from outside ourselves. We cannot free ourselves from old patterns, old values, and archaic errors if we do not first change our own mind. But it does not change with intellectualism or reasoning, but with meditative and awakening practices that revolutionize our thought patterns, which are the basis of our convictions and beliefs. We live in a time of adversity, and this calls for people of integrity and steadfastness. But let us not feel sorry for ourselves, convinced that the world is going badly, because if it is any consolation, it was even worse in the past. We are in a difficult period of history, but this is not exactly new. It is a troubled time like so many others, and if we have come this far, there is no reason to think that we could not go further. Humanity has already faced great challenges, and we are more ready than ever to face the new difficulties that lie ahead. Chapter 3. Peace and Unconditional Love. I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final word in reality. This is why right, temporarily defeated, is stronger than evil triumphant. Martin Luther King. The new spiritualized science. The wise men of every age have always told us that love is everywhere and is a force that connects everything, and today science confirms this. There is a deep connection between us and others, between us and the universe, and with everything that happens to us. Biology, physics, and neuroscience are discovering that the ancient intuitive wisdom of the wise masters was imbued with a profound truth, which is now increasingly shared by that part of the scientific world that is more open. This is a very important point because cutting-edge science gives greater credibility to these truths. Above all, this is true in a very rational Western culture where one needs to satisfy the logical mind. So science opens up to new logics, helps to change our mental models, can be a bridge for more and more people to approach a philosophical and spiritual view of existence, and allows us to lead beyond the reductionist materialism that old science had helped to create. This is all well and good, and an important step, although it is still not enough. Science can give intelligent answers to a rational mind, but let us remember that to really experience the state of oneness with the whole, to really feel the love in us, we need to go beyond our own logical mind. To reach the state of deep meditation, we need to literally silence the conscious mind. So science opens us up to new logics, helps to change our mental models, can be a bridge for more and more people to approach a philosophical and spiritual view of existence, and allows us to lead beyond the reductionist materialism that old science had helped to create. This is all well and good and an important step, although it is still not enough. Science can give intelligent answers to our rational mind, but let us remember that to really experience the state of oneness with the whole, to really feel the love in us, we need to go beyond our own logical mind. To reach the state of deep meditation, we need to literally silence the conscious mind. True love is unconditional. Couples' love is a dual form of love, as it is always conditional, needs fulfillment, and cannot be separated from the beloved, who is seen as the source of its own pleasure. And it is this duality that gives rise to feelings of possession, jealousy, and attachment. True love, as the wise masters have always told us, is unconditional love. When we love unconditionally, we become one with everything. We no longer feel like a solitary entity, separate from the rest, but a part of the infinite itself. According to quantum physics, which we will discuss in more detail in Chapter 11, we are not simply isolated subjects placed in a certain scenario in which we are separated from everything else. According to quantum physics, we are immersed in a field which is constantly co-created by our thoughts and energy, just as this field is modified by the thoughts and energies of all the inhabitants of the planet. Therefore, we are not mere subjects placed in a static and unchanging scenario. We are not merely passive observers contemplating reality and being subjected to it. In quantum physics, it is the observer who creates reality. We are therefore simultaneously the observer and what is observed. We are the one who is creating what he is observing. Being love means that I, the subject, become one with the object of my love and become love with the whole. Love has a great impact on our body, our mind, and our whole being. This is an energy that heals, cures, modifies the electromagnetic field of the heart, affects the activation and inactivation of our genes, and thus modifies our own gene expression. Love is everywhere as a unifying principle in both the infinitely large and the infinitely small, and when we become one with universal love, we radiate these positive vibrations outside of ourselves, which are good for ourselves and for all other living beings. If enough people were able to be love and radiate it outwards, then change, peace and justice would become real. According to quantum physics, we are in a holographic or fractal universe. We will talk about this in more detail in Chapter 11, but in short, this means that in the universe in which we live, every change, even a small change in our way of thinking, will be reproduced everywhere, and this means that every change we make spreads to the infinite and has an influence on the whole. This universal law, the very nature of our fractal universe, means that even if we appear to be small and insignificant compared to the society we live in, and if we appear to be powerless in front of people of power who occupy key positions within institutions and governments, we are actually much more powerful than we believe and are made to believe. Every thought we have of peace and love spreads forever and into infinity, and for eternity will have a positive influence. When the infinitely small changes, the infinitely large is also directly affected. We are parts of a whole and we are governed by the law of love, which unifies and pacifies. This also applies to our organism, or rather to that cellular community we call our body. The overall health of our being depends first and foremost on the level of well-being of each of our individual cells. When each of our cells vibrates coherently on the frequencies of love, the state of unity is created, in which the cells vibrate in unison and become one with the global being that we are. Love is an energy, and loving therefore means emanating a certain energy, vibrating at a certain frequency. Gratitude. The water formula, H2O. O is one molecule of love. H2 is two molecules of gratitude. Masaru Emoto. Expressing gratitude for all that we have and all that we are should be part of our daily life. It is fundamental to focus our attention on what we have and be grateful for it, and not to complain about what we do not have, what we do not know, and what we are not. Being grateful for what you have nourishes inner joy and blocks complaining, a real poison for a harmony. To be grateful is to vibrate on a high energetic frequency, which elevates us and keeps us in a state of pure being, where we experience our innate ability to live in the here and now without the need for anything. Gratitude is an indispensable ingredient for the inner revolution. It leads us to look within and prioritize our inner selves as the way to change. The opposite of gratitude is the lament that always leads us to our outer self, leads us to search for outer illusions and to believe that when we will have, know or be, then we can change things, but this does not happen at all. Gratitude is the manifestation of being in its intrinsic expression of itself and its completeness. If we focus on what we do not have, we give energy to scarcity, we will vibrate on energetic frequencies of poverty and lack, and as a result, receive back further scarcity and lack. We grow what we give attention to, and that is energy. If we are grateful for what we have, we send positive vibrations to the universe, messages of satisfaction, and it will give us back even more.
Piu pensi di avere, ipiu avrai.
The more you think you don't have, the less you get. The more you feel you have, the more you will get back, even on the material plane. The less you feel you have, the less you will get back. It is essential to pay attention to what we say and to our inner dialogue. The right words and thoughts lead us towards awakening, the wrong ones towards dullness. Words and thoughts are not abstract things. They are vibrations, and therefore they are energy. If we say, I don't have enough, I am lacking, if I had, if I could have, when I have, if I will be, then I will change, we are only giving energy to scarcity, to a sense of inadequacy, and we are receiving more scarcity. And this does not lead to change. If we complain, we call up and attract to ourselves situations that will induce us to confirm our complaint. Gratitude is a message we send to the all, and the all itself, like a mirror, will reflect its gratitude back to us. Gratitude leads us to the magic of the present moment and stops our rational mind, which in 90% of cases processes negative thoughts and emotions. Therefore, once the underlying mental negativity is blocked, we can finally express joy and love. Unity and division. The fragmentations, divisions, and conflicts that are tearing our world apart are obvious and there for all to see. Reliance on international rules, treaties, or supranational institutions alone as a means of ending such diatribes is purely illusory. Hoping for top-down solutions to resolve issues is what we normally try to do, but these alone cannot work. A change of perspective is needed, and each of us feeling ourselves to be active and responsible citizens of our own and other people's problems must undertake a process of personal growth in awareness. We consciously choose unity rather than unconsciously following division. Division is the result of unconscious emotionality, whereas unity is the expression of our deeper nature, which tends to unite and integrate rather than divide and conflict. Division is always generated by the emotional mind, which is constantly prey to fears, insecurities, and emotional deficiencies. The sage sees in the other an opportunity for confrontation and thus for mutual growth. The emotional mind, insecure and weak, sees others as potential enemies and competitors. With collaboration, we can achieve much more than with division. We have the opportunity in every moment of our lives to choose between a state of ordinary mind and separatist vision with the whole, or to feel part of the universe in which we feel one with everything around us. When we are one with the infinite, we become unconditional love and thus manifest the most powerful energy of change, which will lead us to universal peace. Altruism versus selfishness. True altruism is that which makes others grow and makes us better because we choose to do so. It is we who in full conscience decide to perform an act of generosity, and this choice elevates society as a whole. In full freedom, we decide to do our daily good deeds, which grow in the fertile soil of true love, which is something free and unconditional. It is we who decide to act how, where, and when. There is no compulsion, obligation, or sense of duty. It is something born of the spontaneity of being, which knows no ulterior motive and which truly wants to put itself at the service of others. If we were forced into an act of philanthropy or conditioned to do so, for example, for reasons of image or to regain credibility, as many famous people do, then since it is not something decided in full freedom, this apparent altruistic gesture would not be an act of true goodness. Altruism and love go hand in hand and are exercised in freedom of conscience and not for ulterior motives. Doing good for others without expecting anything in return is really acting in the direction of unconditional love, giving it and expecting nothing back. One does not act to receive something but for the pleasure of making the other person grow. The pleasure of making a gesture of help is much greater than the falsely altruistic gesture. False altruism is not true love. It is a form of personal gain and represents a form of slavery to our ego, which wants to be recognized as generous, good, and better than others. Look how good I am. How much money I have donated. This is a manifestation of the ego, which seeks to accumulate for itself the small pleasures arising from feeling recognized or from the need to receive a thank you from someone, all to further fuel the search for approval from others. The false altruism that leads us to do a good deed is generally done for personal gain and makes us subservient to that gain. So we end up being slaves to the need to receive something from outside. We are, so to speak, dependent on the outside world. This happens when we are empty inside, and to fill our inner emptiness, we look outside for what we have not yet found inside. These are always mechanisms of need and dependence, which imply a lack of freedom of consciousness and therefore of true love. We can achieve world peace through meditation. We can achieve world peace through an invincible defense technology, as it has been called, all through our brain's ability to send thoughts of peace and love. This knowledge brings together the age-old practice of meditation and modern science, which is beginning to validate its effectiveness. Today, there are many groups that organize group meditations for peace, both locally and via the internet, to meditate together and to benefit from the exponential effect of group meditation. We can also exercise this power of change on our own at any time of the day when we feel it is appropriate. Even 1 minute of meditation a day is enough to start changing things. We want to focus exclusively on peace. Let's do our best, and if we fail, love will win anyway, maybe elsewhere, in some other part of the universe. Chapter 4. Violence versus kindness. Kindness in words creates confidence. Kindness in thought creates depth. Kindness in giving creates love. Lao Tzu. Kindness. Kindness is a revolutionary act in a world of violence. In a society that is still profoundly patriarchal and macho, where brute force still exerts a certain allure, where toughness and virility seem qualities to be developed, extolled, and proudly displayed, many do not realize that machismo is a cancerous mechanism underlying violence. And it is this last human quality that is the source from which the worst that human beings are capable of, from war to the overpowering of the weakest, from bullying to the stockpiling of atomic weapons, are born. In such a context of overt aggression, kindness is one of the most important human qualities to save us from self-destruction. There are still those who think they are solving the world's problems by beating up the perpetrators of such issues, as if justice and welfare were at the mercy of the one or those who beat the hardest. Let us assume for a moment that absurdly this is indeed the case, and imagine that with muscle power we could actually change things and make equality and welfare prevail. Of course, we know that this is not the case, but let us take a flight of fancy. You who are persuaded that violence is the best option, do you think that you are the ones who beat up harder than those who have been ruling and running the world for centuries? I hope you are joking and that deep down you do not really believe that you can prevail against the system which has its strength, the rational organization of violence. If we put it down to force, we have already lost at the start. We don't have tanks, we don't have organized structures like the police or the secret service, so taking to the streets and making a violent uprising can't work. You want to take to the streets and smash everything? Okay, and then what? Do you want to clash with the police when they have weapons we cannot even imagine? What do you have under your bed to put on the scales of a possible confrontation with the police or worse still with the army? A stick and a pitchfork? Do you have an old post-war rifle in the cellar? Some will think of remediating or constructing some homemade bombshells, but compared to the firepower of the enemy, anything we can have or manufacture will be like a child's firecracker compared to the antagonists. Even if we were to make use of the fact that we are vastly outnumbered, their force is so disruptive that it would be, if they really wanted to, a game for them to stem thousands of people storming the stagecoach. The weapons our adversaries possess are certainly not those of the time of the French Revolution. The riots that have been successful in history have occurred because the forces of law and order have, at some point, sided with the rioters, so in terms of strength, they are largely stronger than we are anyway. And to hope that during a violent uprising, the forces of law and order will take our side is like playing dice. Besides, if a street revolt really succeeded and we managed to get into the accursed palaces of power, what would change? Would we replace the men in charge of the nation? Would we change the government or the parliament? And by reshaping these things after a general uprising, perhaps a bloody one, do you think things would really change? The French Revolution and its ugly copies, we have already done them and seen that they do not work. They are illusions that last the time they last, then everything returns more or less as it was before the uprising. More or less, the substance does not change. If they really worked, we wouldn't be here talking about these things and we would have been living in the best possible world long ago. But I make no secret of the fact that when I see streams of people invading the squares, protesting and claiming their rights, I am very pleased. I see it as a sign that there is a desire for something new and people are willing to give something of themselves to make it happen. But this serves to create a cohesion, a trust between people, a movement of sharing ideas that are fundamental to solving the problem. But these logics of openness, analysis, sharing and confrontation of opinions cannot take place if we go out in the streets and smash everything, break shop windows, set fire to everything, or go to confrontation with the police. That is not dialogue and reflection, but useless anger, wasted energy that ends up legitimizing the power to issue exceptional measures that make our situation even worse. Violent riots have never worked, so why don't we have demonstration where instead of putting anger and rage in the foreground, we put kindness, serenity and harmony in the foreground? Instead of shouting and insults, why don't we arm ourselves with smiles and happiness? The real breakthrough will come when we let kindness prevail over violence, when love takes over from fear and smiles remove the anger from our faces. If violence has never worked, let us try a new recipe. As they say, eating the same soup tires you out and does not work in the long run. Let us try the revolution of kindness and surely, regardless of the results, we will maintain our harmony instead of getting pissed off like beasts. Has anyone ever told you that getting angry is bad for your health? Then why do you want to get so angry? So kindness allows us not only to change the world, but also to preserve our well-being. So let's kill two birds with one stone. So let's bingo. The real revolution will be that of kindness. And once again, it always starts with us first on our individual and personal level. Let us start by being kind to ourselves and consequently to others, to those we come into contact with every day, whether they are people close to us or strangers. And we should also be kind to people we do not like, dislike, or who are completely different from us, including the merry band of multi-billionaires who rule the world and are leading us astray. Kindness is a manifestation of love. We cannot give love if we are not kind. Kindness is often seen as a form of weakness, and this is obvious to a brain still set on the yardstick of brute force. Those who are still conditioned by these ideas may be afraid of being judged, of being considered weak, or cowardly, of not being strong enough to fall into the category of real men. But these are old, failed patterns of thinking which we can put in the museum of human prehistory, relegate to the dustbin of history. The kinder we are to others, the more we receive in return, and the world itself becomes kinder. We all want to be in the company of polite and friendly people. We do not like the presence of rude individuals, so let us be polite to others first. We have to be the ones to set the example. By being polite to people we dislike, we increase the level of kindness in the world. Some people might think that kindness cannot solve the serious problems we face, such as hunger in poor countries, pollution, wars, to give a few examples. But if we were all kind, many of these problems would disappear without having to do who knows what. If we were all gallant and well-mannered, who would start a war? But even further upstream, who would want to declare war or plot under the table to create conflict in a world of noble-minded people? There would be no hunger and certainly more respect for our environment. If billionaires were more in the service of their neighbor, they could, with their immense wealth, help the most suffering part of humanity without diminishing their current standard of living. Right thought, right word, and right action. Roughness and violence are visible both in verbal language and, of course, on the physical plane. But we want to go further and examine a form of violence that is invisible but which has an equally devastating effect on the entire human ecosystem. Violent thought. We talk about meditation for peace, which is a way of using our thinking constructively to bring harmony and hope to the planet. But unfortunately, the mechanism also works the other way around. A nefarious use of thought has utterly destructive consequences. So we must pay close attention to what thoughts we choose to generate. And not only that, we must also pay attention to the stimuli we receive from our environment. If we overdose ourselves daily on the news, stuff ourselves in front of TV talk shows, and spice it all up with a good read of any national newspaper, then we will predispose ourselves to react in a nefarious way because that toxic pseudo-informative swill will be quite indigestible to us and will definitely affect our thinking. Right thought, right word, and right action. Right action stems from right speech, which in turn stems from right thought. So let us not underestimate the importance of our thinking. It too must be kind, as thinking is the basis of our speech and action. Being kind comes from kind thought. Violence is also a cultural and political fact. Evident in television debate and political propaganda are all the lowest stratagems resorted to in order to create consensus, obtain votes, and increase one's popularity. One example of these cunning ploys is the need to create a sense of belonging and identity through the creation of an enemy to be fought or excluded. Kindness operates in the opposite way, is a process of inclusion that tends to include everything in which a sense of identity and belonging is generated through the sharing of the collective good. In kindness, there is room for everyone and no one is excluded or left behind. It turns out to be a necessary process for our own survival, as nature possesses fantastic self-regulating mechanisms tending to eliminate those living species that prove destructive to the entire ecosystem. From the point of view of natural balance, we human beings are a bit like cancer cells that are destroying their own environment. This superficial, cynical, and destructive attitude risks triggering retaliation and serious consequences from nature itself, the consequences of which could be devastating for the human species. We are behaving precisely like cancer cells that isolate themselves from the context in which they are, stop communicating and interacting with their fellows and other living species, and end up devouring and destroying everything around us. Today, we can detect in the Earth ecosystem increasingly intimate and complex levels of interconnectedness and interdependence between all living creatures. Today, we understand that the extinction of a particular species has negative consequences for the whole system. This means that we cannot afford to exclude or fight any living species, be it plant or animal. But the same reasoning also applies to our level as human beings. We can no longer afford to exclude and fight our fellow human beings under fallacious pretexts of artificial divisions and separations dictated by cultural, historical, racial, and propagandistic processes. The more we can live peacefully and inclusively, highlighting the interconnectedness and interdependence between living species, which translates into...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.